Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is Sunday, October 23rd, 2016. Today's the 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. We have 8 o'clock and 10:30 services at St. John's. We have a Wednesday midweek service at 6:30 in the chapel. We have communion the first and third Sundays of the month and every Wednesday evening. We have a food pantry open on every Wednesday, 9 to 10:45. Outreach store open Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, closed on Thursdays, open 9:30 to 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Rainbow table every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Everybody's welcome to share a meal.
St. John's Lutheran Church. This is Sunday, October the 23rd, 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. And this hymn is Love, Lord, Whose Love in Humble Service, written by Alfred Bailey, lived 1901 to 1984. It's to stress humility. It's from the music is from the sacred harp, type of music the United States known for.
Thank you. and page 203 in the front of your worship. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Oh. second reading is from Timothy chapter 2. Second Timothy. For as me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed to hear me. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them, but the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed to all the Gentiles who might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're standing to sing the gospel acclamation. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. We'll be reading the gospel for today. Words of Jesus.
Splendor.
Thank you, ladies. You may at this time take out your sermon notes as we examine Luke 18, verse 9, and the warning that Jesus gives this morning. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. A woman was asked what she thought the reason was for she and her husband being married successfully for 22 years. And she stopped and thought a moment, and then she replied with the words, "Well, I think the reason we have been married for 22 years is that fortunately we both love the same name." You all don't get it either. The first morning prayer. The man was so self-centered that he loved enough for both of them. That's the joke. It's a joke. She loved him and he loved himself. Her minds for a successful marriage. Self-centeredness. That is at the heart of the parable today that Jesus tells about a Pharisee and a tax collector going up to pray. And then self-centered people can be divided into three different types of people. And we see them illustrated by the Pharisee, and we also see them illustrated in other encounters Jesus has, especially with those who oppose him. So the first type of self-centered person that Jesus is speaking to are those who trust in themselves. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves. These people are also made referred to as the self-sufficient. They believe that they are completely self-sufficient and have no need for anyone else. They feel that all they need dwells within their minds, their bodies, and their souls. They feel that no one else need to be consulted. The word trust that we have in our gospel lesson today is from a Greek word that literally means to have confidence in oneself, which having confidence in yourself isn't a bad thing. We have too many people in the world who don't have confidence in themselves and don't take advantage of the gifts God has given them because of that lack of confidence. But this is a negative type of self-confidence. This is having confidence in oneself in an arrogant and detrimental way. And to have this arrogant, detrimental confidence in such a way that you have no doubt that you are always right. Now, I'm sure most of us gathered here today have known someone just like that. Someone who always knows they're right. No matter the topic, no matter the subject, no matter the situation, they're always right. They trust totally in themselves. These type of people have the feeling that neither God nor anyone else is really necessary in their life. They don't need them. And as they plow through life, the farthest thing from their mind would be to call upon God or someone else when facing a situation. These type of people are filled with pride and conceit. And oftentimes that pride and conceit has nothing to do with them themselves, but has to do with the family they were born into, or the financial condition they are in, or some other type of circumstance that really they had nothing to do with. But they take that pride and that conceit because of either their family, tradition, name, whatever. Growing up in the Commonwealth of Kentucky, there were still certain family names that immediately brought recognition. And usually people with those names found themselves being able to do things that you or I would have to really struggle and work hard for to obtain. Kentucky as a state commonwealth after it split off from Mother Virginia. Some of it has to do with people who were powerful politicians or powerful businessmen or whatever before the Great War between the states, during it or after it. And so you would need a descendant from one of these families. You had some who would be very humble and very nice, but you had others who immediately would look down their nose at you because you were not a whatever. I'm not going to mention the names, but if you've researched the history of the Commonwealth of Kentucky, it'll be pretty obvious what names I'm referring to. So these people feel they're self-sufficient. They don't need God, they don't need you or me, they don't need anything. And so they are self-centered, and that self-centeredness causes them to be so full of pride that they're not even concerned about their relationship with God. Now D.L. Moody, the famous evangelist, speaking of such people, said, quote, "God sends no one away empty except those who are full of themselves in the world." God will not send us away empty when we come to Him in humility. When we are like the tax collector, not even raising our head or face to heaven, but keeping our head bowed, looking at the ground and saying, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." God will never turn us away when that's granted. But when we come to God like that Pharisee, thinking He's done everything necessary to be right with God. "Oh Lord, I'm glad I'm not like the extortionists and the adulterers and the connivers and the rogues and the thieves and the thugs. Well, I pray every day, I give a tenth of what all my goods, I fast twice a week. Aren't I just so wonderful?" Well, that's the type of people Moody is saying God will send away. After all, they trust in themselves. They don't trust in God. So that's the first type of self-centered person. The second type of self-centered person are those who are self-righteous. These self-righteous differ from the self-sufficient in that they are interested in righteousness and in God. But, unfortunately, too often in a wrong way. The word righteous that we have translated in our gospel lesson is a Greek word which means to think you are just, holy, or innocent in the eyes of God by your own doing. So now, if you think you are just, holy, or innocent in the eyes of God because of your faith in Jesus Christ, that would be correct. But to think you're just, holy, and innocent in the eyes of God because of what you have done, you're in for a rude awakening. Because what you've done matters little to God. Especially if what you have done has been motivated by trying to earn favor instead of from a heart of love, responding to the love that God first shows us through the giving of His Son, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. So here we have the second group of self-centered, the self-righteous, and these self-righteous can be divided into two camps. The first is those who feel that they are good enough for God just as they are. They feel like what they do is sufficient, how they do it is fine, and they don't have to do anything else. God will take them. They have done enough and are doing enough good for God to accept them. They think that when they stand face to face with God, that God would never reject them. After all, they were righteous. They did this and that. They were so much better than everybody else around. True, they do wrong, but they don't do enough wrong to counter all the good they do. So God will not reject or condemn them for eternity because of the wrong. Their goodness satisfied them. They go about life living it as they wish, worshiping God enough to satisfy their conscience, and doing enough good works to satisfy their own self-centeredness. What is sad is that this is the attitude but probably the vast majority of people in the world. Not Christian people only, but all people in the world, no matter what religion they follow or whether they follow anything or not. When you talk to people so often, like if you do a man on the street interview and ask people, do you think you're good enough to go to heaven? Except for the occasional atheist you may run into in that interview, the majority of people, not all of them, are saying, well, yeah, I'm a good person. I'm nice to my neighbor. I'm nice to my neighbor's daughter. I'm nice to my co-workers. You know, I give a little bit of money to charity every year. So, sure, God will let me go into heaven. You never hear them say, I am not good enough to go into heaven, but I will be there because of the grace of God through my faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. It is the idea that they are good enough just as they are. So few people believe that they will be rejected by God and refused entrance into the kingdom. They feel they have enough goodness to make themselves acceptable to God just as they are. Mark Twain tells the story of a ruthless businessman he knew. But this businessman also thought that he was self-righteous, or that he was righteous. And one day he came to Mark Twain and he said, you know what, Brother Mark? I'm going to go take a pilgrimage to the Holy Land. And when I get to the Holy Land, I'm going to go to Mount Sinai. And I'm going to climb up Mount Sinai. When I get to the very top, I'm going to read aloud the Ten Commandments. Mark Twain thought about that for a moment, and he says, I have a better idea. You could just stay here in Boston and keep them. See, the self-righteous then, by doing something like reciting the Ten Commandments, makes them better than somebody else, or makes up for all the bad they do. And here he was, he could read them, but he obviously wouldn't follow them. So that's the first type of self-righteous. They think they're fine just as they are. They don't have any problems with what they do. God will accept them as they are. They don't need faith in Jesus Christ. They don't need someone to die for their sins and wash their sins away with their blood. They don't need the Savior to rise on that third day and ascend 40 days later, waiting to come again to assure them a victory over sin, death, and the devil. They're righteous in themselves and what they do. Now, the second type of self-righteous, which unfortunately makes up a percentage of Christians still today, are the self-righteous who have a sensitive conscience and feel the need to give themselves to good works as much as humanly possible. The old works righteousness belief. The basis of the religions of the world. Do enough good things, and you will earn entrance into the kingdom. And so they go about doing good works, not as a response to the love that God has first shown us through the gift of His Son, Jesus Christ, but they do these good works in order to secure favor with God. It becomes a bargaining chip. God, look at all these things I've done. Look at all these wonderful things that I've done. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all that I have you. I'm not like all these other people. I go to church every time the doors are open. I'm involved in every committee. Look at how wonderful I am. So that is their motivation, and they think they can then bargain with God to enter into the kingdom. They believe their good works would make them good and righteous and build them up in the eyes of God. Totally ignoring the fundamental of Christianity, which is salvation is by grace through faith, apart from works of the law. That salvation is based not on what we do, but it's based on what Jesus Christ has already done. Yes, we do good works, but we do them as a response to that love that God first showed us. We do them in order to imitate Jesus Christ. We do them as a way of bringing the light of Christ into a world that is starving for salvation, starving for freedom from oppression, starving to know that there is a God in heaven who is not this horrible judge just waiting for you to step out of line so he can zap you as quick as possible, but that he's a God who loves you so much that he sent his son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. That is Christianity. That is the faith of Christianity. But there are still Christians who fall into the self-righteous trap along with those who aren't Christians. Now, there's a number of people, not only in America, but throughout the world, who consider themselves, quote, religious. Or they consider themselves not religious, but spiritual. And what they mean by that is, if they think they're religious, they say, well, I do this and that. Going back to what I said before, being nice to my neighbor, and I'm kicking my neighbor's dog, you know, nice to my co-workers, blah, blah, blah. On the other hand, those who think they're spiritual, they don't believe in any kind of organized religion, but they think they're in tune with nature, and they're in tune with whatever the spirit is that controls all of us. And that's what they believe. So again, if you did that interview on the street, man on the street interview, and you asked them, do you think you're going to heaven? They would say yes, either for being religious, doing all kinds of deeds and obeying all kinds of laws, or by being spiritual, being in tune with nature and with the forces of nature and the spirit, whatever it is that energizes all of us. Again, we need the buzzer from the game show to buzz. Wrong answer. Salvation is by grace. But unfortunately, as I say, there are Christians who try their best to make themselves acceptable to God through their works instead of through simple faith in what Jesus has done. I've told you this story before, but I forget how long ago it was that I told you. But the first parish I served was in Evansville, Indiana. And one day I had a conversation with a member of the church. He had grown up in the church, was baptized, went through confirmation, was confirmed, and spent her whole life in the church, married, had 8 children. If you believe this, a set of twins and then a set of triplets besides the other children she had before that. And so we were talking one day, and the topic of salvation and heaven came up. And she told me, she looked me right in and she said, Pastor, this is what I really believe. Well, this is a lady who had been Lutheran all her life, went to confirmation, recited Luther's catechism, learned Luther's small catechism, been in Sunday school, Bible school. She said, what I believe it is that God really does have a big book, and all our names are in it. And every day God's angels under his direction opens that book and comes to our name and puts down good marks when we do something good during the day and a bad mark when we do something bad. And she said, I truly believe that when I die, I'll stand before God and he will open this book and he will count it, or have the angels count up my bad marks and total them up. Then he'll total up my good marks, and whichever is the greater is where I'll go. And I just sat there in stunned silence. How did this woman grow up in a Lutheran church believing salvation would be based on the good or bad instead of being based on the cross of Jesus Christ? But this second type of self-righteous people you find in the church as well as in the secular world. You find them in the world religions because that's what the world religions are based on, you doing good things and obeying a bunch of laws and rules and regulations to earn favor with God. And Jesus Christ showed us how that is all wrong. That what we are to do is to have faith in him and what he has done. And salvation is a gift. And eternal life is a gift. And a mansion is a gift. So that is the second group of self-centered people. The third are when Jesus says, he told this parable to some who trusted in themselves and they were righteous and who despised others or treated others with contempt. The word despise means contempt. It also means to see others as worthless, to see them as useless, to see them as unimportant and insignificant, to give them no esteem, no value, to consider them below. This type of attitude is what gives rise to horrible things like Nazism, racism, sexism, and all the other evil isms in the world. When you think you are better than someone else simply because of your race, creed, color, gender, ethnic origin, where you grew up, where you were born, where you live, what family you're part of, any of those kind of things make you think you're better than someone else, you better listen to Jesus' warning. Because those are not the kind of people that enter into the kingdom of heaven. The Pharisee despised the tax collector. Despised him because the tax collector was not able to fulfill the laws and demands that the Pharisee thought God wanted you to fulfill the demand and that he demanded. And so he had no use for them. Just like the Pharisee had no use for Gentiles. He had no use for Samaritans. He had no use for fellow Jews that were not like him. If they couldn't do what he did, then they were no good. And so the third kind of self-centered person are those who have contempt or despise others just because of who they are. Not because they've done anything to them. Not because they caused any kind of problem. It's just they're different. They're not me. And the world revolves around me. That's the attitude of the self-centered. And so these are the people that Jesus is directing. And they are the ones to whom he gives this warning. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The warning is, if you're self-centered, if you trust only in yourself, then you're self-sufficient. If you are self-righteous, or if you despise others, the kingdom of heaven is not your destination. But if you're humble, if you look in the mirror and realize that maybe you have done some of these things or had some of these attitudes, then you simply come to Jesus in repentance. And like the tax collector, you simply say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And the blood of Jesus Christ will wash away that sin. And the Holy Spirit will wipe those attitudes out of your heart and mind by trusting in Jesus Christ. So there is a warning in today's parable. A warning that we all need to hear because as human beings, whether we want to admit it or not, at one time or another, we have all had that feeling that we were better than somebody else for some reason or another. It's like when I've been asked the question, how can God forgive someone who does some kind of horrible crime, and then once in prison, they become a follower of Jesus Christ and they change your life. They've still done such a horrible crime. And my answer to that is the same way Jesus Christ can forgive me. He can forgive you. I haven't murdered anybody. I haven't robbed anybody else. But I've had times when I've had terrible thoughts in my heart. I've had times when I've done things that have been very cruel. There have been times that I have done things that I'm totally ashamed of. And so if God is willing to forgive me and save me, why can we not save the repentant killer or thief or mugger or whatever? So we are not to be arrogant. We are not to be self-centered. But always trust and have confidence in the forgiveness and salvation that our Lord Jesus Christ gives us through faith in Him. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing, "There Shall Be Showers of Blessing," which is on the back cover of your book. Showers of Blessing on the back cover.
It's a gospel hymn, "There Shall Be Showers of Blessing." It was written by Daniel W. Whittle, W-H-I-T-T-L-E. And he was one of the songs that he learned in childhood. And he wrote this song for children. It uplifts us with the happy assurance of God's unceasing blessing in our lives, even on the worst days. It was written in 1883 by Daniel Whittle.
Thank you.
now time for our offering. The ushers will come forward. Janet Hoag and Sharon Leach are the ushers today.
We have music by the ladies' quartet from the choir. Listen to this. It's on the theme of humility. The publican and the tax collector. The publican is honored because he trusts in God, doesn't believe in self-righteousness, doesn't look down on other people, but confesses that he is a sinner. This is what God expects of us. He expects of us to acknowledge that we're saved by grace.
God's saving grace, let us pray for the church and for all God's creation in need. Our response today is, Lord, hear our prayer. For understanding and unity among all believers, that when we wander from God's path, you will gently bring us back, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For this congregation, that we may know your presence whenever we feel alone, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For those in danger from war, violence, poverty, or oppression, that the church would assist in making your reign of justice known worldwide, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For those suffering from despair, fear, or illness, that they may be safe and comforted in God's care, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. We bless you for the joys we receive when we sing praise for God's creation and all our blessings. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. In the company of St. Simon and St. Jude and all renewers of the church, may we anticipate that day when we will all feast together at your table. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Hear these in all our prayers of God, in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with God, the Ever Great Redeemer, hymn number 618, in the back of your worship.
This hymn was written by William Williams, a Welsh preacher who once preached to 80,000 people. Preached at the time of the Great Awakening, time of the Wesleys and the Jonathan Edwards in the United States, the Great Revival that swept the world. And William Williams was the preacher in Wales, preached to many people, traveled thousands of miles. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer, or guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Us on YouTube. We welcome you to St. John's Lutheran Church service. Our morning services are at 8 o'clock every Sunday and 10:30 every Sunday. Sunday school at 9:15, midweek service at 6:30 p.m. Nursery care 10 a.m. to 11:45 every Sunday. Holy Communion is celebrated the first and third Sunday of each month. Festivals and every Wednesday evening. Watch our services on YouTube. We have an announcement. We have a youth outing the first Sunday in November, chaperoned by Jan and Gary Dave. Meet in our parking lot, Lowry Avenue, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And the admission to the skating rink, is the roller skating rink, will be covered, and also pizza party for the youth or anybody who wants to come. We'll call the church office if you're interested. The Dave's grandchildren are coming and their friends. We should have a good group. This is the 23rd Sunday after Pentecost, October the 23rd, 2016. We're happy to have you worship with us today. We'd like to have you worship in person. Come help us as we have a mission here to feed the hungry. We feed 8,000 people every month, provide them food, some hot meals, and we provide them food to take with them. Thank you for watching St. John's. Tune in anytime. Our church offers a Christian school program. We hope to get it started again in January. Tune in anytime. Thank you for joining us in our worship this Lord's Day. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you and continue to pray for us. Don't forget the Yuletide Festival in November. Yuletide Festival is November 17th, 18th, and 19th. We are happy today that we have live flowers today in front of the altar, presented by church members and all their families. We always have live flowers. Joe and Diane Myers and family in loving memory of David Myers on his birthday. Jerry and Phyllis Cochran in loving memory of Marilyn Miller. We're happy to have these people giving the flowers. This offers also a blessing. We have music, we have the word, we have nature, we have everything here. God wants us here to worship Him. He asks us to worship Him. And this is for us. And He gives us His Holy Spirit to be with us forever. And He worships us. We worship Him and we receive blessing from God. We're happy to have you worship with us anytime, any Sunday. And you can come anytime. In summer we have the drive-in service. Come as you are in your car. And all the rest of the year, we are here in the sanctuary. 8 o'clock service and the 10:30 service. Yuletide Festival, November 17th, 18th, 19th. Outing at the roller skating rink the first Sunday in November. The church services. Come and be help us as we feel our mission is to the poor. And this is what God says. Humility, this was the emphasis today in the service. As the publican says, God have mercy on me, a sinner. His humility, we believe we should do good works just because we love God and because of the grace we receive from Him that we're able to good works and not of ourselves, not self-righteous. That was Pastor's sermon today. So I'm glad to have you with us. We are happy to bring this service to you. And you can worship right along with us and receive God virtually through the ministry of the YouTube and the computer. We're using the electronic ministry given to us by God to reach out to others.